So we have a restoration here on tooth number 30. Was diagnosed with cracked tooth syndrome and moderate occlusal attrition. So we're going to remove the existing composite filling, which is an MOD, and we are going to prep it for a full coverage restoration, zirconia material. So that's our diagnosis and treatment plan. Okay. All right, so what we're going to do is build this up with a core build-up material. This is clear fill, non-etched dental adhesive. And we're going to use material here that's specifically for build-ups. It's a composite ionomer. And very good, it's tooth friendly, and very dental decay resistance. It's a dual type of material, so it's light cured and also cures on its own. I'm not worried about getting on the other tooth at this point because I know it can be cleaned off fairly easy. Just takes a few hits of the plasma arc light to cure. I'm giving it a little rest in between because it's exothermic, especially when accelerated with the light.
Left a little bit. Thank you.
turn towards me, please? You can really see the, I don't know if you can see, but there, you can visibly see the fractures on this lingual, straight lingual aspect. And we just want to trace those. You can really see in this angle. I don't know, can you see it, Devin?
Yeah, I'm able to adjust the brightness.
Section. So what you want to do is you want to try to cover those with your restoration, obviously, to help the idea. And we'll note in our records that there is visible fractures. Sometimes even we'll take a photograph of it so that we know if we have any postoperative sense problems. We can refer back to those notes and know we had visible fractures in the tooth and treat appropriately. Okay. I got back to the middle piece. At least a millimeter reduction, maybe a millimeter and a half to two, even on the occlusal, but on the other surfaces, I like about a millimeter. It just lends to a strong crown. I rarely have these go to endo afterward, which I hear reports. 25% of crowns end up needing endo, but our propensity for that is very, there's no way near 25%. I think we have 4, maybe. Okay. Section. Okay, bite down this, what we're doing, bite down and hold it. What we're doing is checking for occlusal clearance. Okay, and open. Right down there, hold it. Right, and open. Okay, right down there. Good, okay. I know we don't have enough reduction.
Yeah.
Okay, and open, please. Back right down again. Okay, give me some wax. There's a little trick here we use. You can, if you can't see if you have enough reduction, you can get some rope wax, which we pre-make and load, so that's ready to go. And you can check her clearance. And open. Quiet down, Beth, crush the wax. And open. And that shows me if she has enough clearance. And if you look here, see my blue glove coming through. This is okay here, but see this part of her upper stamp cusp is coming down in the area of the lower tooth, and it's just not reduced enough. So we're just going to hit that. So we'll leave everything else alone, and that will ensure that we have proper reduction. Okay, bite down, crush the wax. Good, and open. You're getting there, almost. Almost. Bite down, crush the wax. Good, and open. Bite down, Beth, hold it. And open. Bite down again. Okay. You see a little brown area coming through on the top. It is not decay. It is stain from the filling and maybe some old silver filling there. But if you go after every piece of stain in a tooth, a lot of these teeth will have nothing left. And you need to be able to differentiate from that, so that you still leave good tooth structure. Okay. Now I'm just going to detail a few things. And open, turn left a little bit. Just so that my margin is clean and anytime I can keep a margin super gingival, I will. It's just healthier for the gum tissue. I don't want any sharp lines. Let's kind of torch in here a little bit. Okay. We look pretty good. Yeah. I always go back and just run some polish over the interproximal so that they're smooth and you get a nice contact. And it doesn't take much to do. And it helps a lot. Turn in the middle, thank you. Okay, now what we're going to do is, I don't know how you're going to film this because we're going to use a laser and you shouldn't really be looking at it.
Mm-hmm. So,
I'm going to
put these on.
I don't pack cord on posterior teeth. I use a laser and...
Can you see?
Then, laser is a diode laser. We use it about 1.5 to 2 watts. Okay, so why I use a laser is because it works phenomenal to expose the margin. If it's used properly, you don't cauterize tissue. And why I love the laser is it goes after all the inflammatory tissue, granulation tissue, go in section and clean the field. It creates collagen and it really, really helps with healing. That's why I use it. So you can see she's a little inflamed down here. I'm just going to lightly go around it. And in doing so, I expose my margin. And I'll be able to see where I want to detail some things more. And I try to be conservative as possible with it. I need another number, a cuber in the ancient. Okay. That's a lot better. You gotta be gentle with the laser. You just can't go in there with a rip roaring around and it takes you to create damage. You just want to expose the margin in there so the pressure can replicate the margin. Now, when you see teeth with attrition on them, where something's causing that, besides food and bruxism, but the driving force is that no matter what category they're under, why it's caused, the upper tooth is one doing it. That's the culprit. So over years, what happens is teeth like to move and they'll wear and they'll move and they'll extrude and they'll start constricting space. Now if I keep reducing this, I'm going to be down in close to the pulp, and I don't want to do that. That's ridiculous. You run out of room, so you want to preserve that as best as possible. She's got plenty of enamel up here that's kind of extruded in place on this upper first molar, number three. So what I'm going to do, and this is really prevalent on second molars, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to just take this down a little bit so it's not hitting and intruding on this tooth, so that the crown has to be too thin or I have to do more reduction. So you do that to help compensate for the movement of the tooth due to wear. And you guys will learn as time goes on. I'm not going to get into bite collapse and all that stuff. Just go up here and gently do this. It's called enamelplasty. It does not hurt the tooth if you're conservative about it. And we'll polish this up and place a little fluoride on top afterwards. But she's not even numb here. Beth, are you doing okay?
Mm-hmm.
And she doesn't feel it. It's like a manicure. If you go too far, they're going to feel it. But if you're conservative, and just reshape, okay, the bite down and hold it. It's basically all I needed. And open. I'm just going to smooth this out there a little bit. Okay. Now you see, you got a little bit of hemorrhage right there, which is normal. The tissue's fine, it's not beat up. And so, our impression material does not like fluid. It's hydrophobic. So we use this. It's a, viscostat material, and it just cleans up the tissue and stops it from bleeding there a little bit, so you get a good impression. Okay, so if you, it tastes horrible. Sorry about that. But it works good. Now when she comes back, all this tissue you see is red, and you've got a little pet. That will clean, that will be healed beautifully. And it'll look better than when she came in. I wish I could show you some of that. It's pretty amazing. That's why we use it. All right, so let's do it. All right, so Fatima is going to get us ready for our impression. It's a single unit. We have posterior occlusal stop, so we can do a triple bite here just fine and take care of her. All right. We're going to take an impression. It's okay, go. So Fatima, my assistant, mixing the putty. She'll tell me when to do the light body. This is thinner, so it gives us more accuracy. Okay, Beth, bite down all the way. Yep, perfect. So she's closed good. We'll still take a little bite registration for the lab, but that'll take about 3 minutes to dry. So just stay closed there, Beth. You can see with this impression material, the margin looks very nice. It's clean, it's precise. So we got a good impression the first time. You don't always get it the first time, but we got it this time.
Okay, back down. Tap. like down and grind your teeth. It's really tight, but I'm gonna leave it like that because that will keep it in your mouth. For I think it's gonna be like 2.5 weeks. Do you floss every day?
Pretty much.
Okay. The contact on this one is really tight. To floss it, you'll have to go down and pull through. Because if you pull that, you could pull the temple.
Yeah, because sometimes it doesn't come back up, so I just pull it through.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, I'm gonna play a video with all the instructions.
Okay.
And if you have any questions, you can ask me.
Okay.